Now security concerns in the southeast raise even more as the house of the Imo State governor hopes of being attacked. And former Speaker of the House of Representatives, Yakubu Degara, tells us the consequences of choosing the wrong leaders in 2023. This is Plus Politics, and I am Justin Akadomi. Now, over the weekend, the house of the Imo State Governor, Hope Uzodinma, was attacked and set on fire by gunmen. The Commissioner for Information, Declan Emelumba, said a few casualties were recorded after security men on guard replied or reported the attack. Now, this incident is added to the various violent events that have taken place in the southeastern part of the country. Now, joining me to discuss this is Kisinga Ikoku, a public affairs analyst, and Dixon Osaji, a security expert. Good evening to you, gentlemen. Many thanks for joining us on Plus Politics on Plus TV Africa. Let's just start this way. I just want to get your quick impression concerning the attack on the Imo State governor's house. That's Hope Uzodinma. What does all of this tell you? Let me start with you, Kisinga.
First of all, I would say it is a crisis of leadership and lack of trust and communication, because part of the duties of a governor of a state is to be the chief security officer of the state.
Let me butt in, Kisinga. When you say lack of trust and communication, on whose part? Who's not trusting who here and who's not communicating?
Of course, a lot of attacks have happened, and we seem not to have resolved them. When they attacked at the heart of the government house here in Owerri, you had our governor, you had the President Buhari say it was caused by IPOB. Then the police said it was IPOB, and our governor said, no, it was political detractors. And while we are yet to resolve that puzzle, then we now saw the recent attack in the house of the governor. So for me, I believe it demands a multifaceted approach towards solving the problem. We need to unravel who are these people? Who are these people attacking military and security formations in the state? What is their agenda? What do they want? We have to identify them first. Let us agree on the intelligence that is coming. The governor blames political detractors on the one side. The security agencies, who we feel have the intelligence, say it is this group. So for now, we have not gotten it right from what we hear from the government house of Imo State. And from there, it is when we have now identified the problem that we can begin to talk about the solution.
All right, thank you, Kisinga. Let me get to Dixon Osaji for a minute now. Dixon, you are a security expert. There seems to be a whole lot, going on behind the scene. Kisinga talked about trust, issue of trust and communication, but right now, who do we even hold responsible for this particular attack? Like he rightly said, the governor came out to say that the IPOB is not responsible for the attack. You know, the former IGP is saying that the attacks in the southeast, are done by the IPOB, the ESN, and all of that. Then again, in the wake of all of this, there's this the stand of the British government are offering asylum to the IPOB members, and not too long after that, now the army comes out and says they have killed some IPOB commanders. So what do we make? What sense can we make out of all of this?
Well, it will make no sense, because first of all, let me address the area of Governor Hope Uzodinma. I think he needs to calm down because Except is assuming the position of an IPO of Imo State or the new investigation police officer, because it is detrimental to the survival of intelligence gathering when a number one citizen of the state will come on air and release information of an investigation that has not been concluded. You know, when we talk about investigation, reporting, you must go through the initial report, then followed by progress report, followed by special report, before final report. Now, when a number one citizen, when the number one citizen of the state comes on air to start confirming the people or the group of criminal elements that carry out such attacks, that simply implies that he's giving a final report. And I will advise him to come back to his security advisor that to advise him properly in releasing information to the public. Now, going back to the incident that happened in his hometown, you see, the problem we have here in our own country, we don't prioritize risk. If you don't prioritize your risk, you cannot apply mitigation factors. We all understand that Imo State has been going through some form of attack. And I would like to inform you that when you begin to experience such kind of attack on military hard target, on civilian soft target, that tells you that a new terrorism has been born. And if a new terrorism has been born, what I have expected the military to do and the federal government of Nigeria to do is not to respond with military might. You know, that was the mistake they made in the uproar of Boko Haram, sending in the military without giving the police an opportunity to try and fail, because we must give the Nigerian police the opportunity to try and fail.
Okay, Dixon.
Before the military can come on board. But here, in any given situation, the military will just rush on board, carry out bombardment, carry out shooting. Military might anywhere in the world can never be the first response in terrorism.
All right, Dixon.
I think the state government should calm down, carry out a risk assessment of what is happening, then they will be able to prioritize the mitigation factors.
All right, I want to really get your assessment, because you mentioned something that just struck me. You said new terrorism. Would you label the attacks on the parts of the southeastern state in recent times as terrorism? Would you also say there is a link between the series of attacks at the on security formation and, of course, on the Imo State Governor's house and other southeastern states? Would you say they're interlinked?
Well, for me, I think that's strategic, because when a criminal element begins to attack a military formation, what they're trying to do is to psychologically demoralize the military. Because if you don't psychologically demoralize the military, they will not succeed in their operation. So I felt that those recent attacks, and these attacks are so frequent, you know, and the criminal progressing in their various attack in all the locations. So for me, I think it's a new bet. It's a new bet. A new terrorism has been born. But I will advise the southern governors to come on board to quickly nip this on the board, because if they don't do that, I am afraid the perception will be a very different perception, because people just felt that they can attack any military formation, attack any police formation, and these people are killing their own brothers, killing their sisters. So.
All right, thank you. Akisiga, let's us bring you back onto this discussion. You have heard what Dixon Osagie says, his assessment, and he said that a new terrorism has been birthed. Let me get your candid opinion really right now. You know, in all of this, that there are talks of, fifth columnist in the offing between security organizations. There are talks that they are the ones perpetrating the violence in the Southeast, and that is why it has actually spiraled out of control. How do you reason all of that?
This is very true. You know, injustice everywhere is a major cause of this kind of civil strife. You know, before now, IPOB had existed. Let me give you, there have been agitations. This is, you have seen what is happening all over the country. The country is now resting. A lot of people are not coming out. These are as a result of all the agitations that has piled up, which the leadership of the country at the various levels have continued to frustrate. Your citizens will be talking. You don't want to listen to them. You don't want to listen to the voices of your citizens. You believe everything is military man. Let me give you an instance. There was a time when the Southeast will always cry. at any agitation, people will just do a rally or demonstration. They will militarize everywhere, you know, create those checkpoints that will be very tight for vehicular movement to show us that we are a conquered people. You'll be looking at the checkpoints, I'll be thinking if the Southeast is even Maiduguri, if there was war going on. But that was mere the demonstration and the carrying of placards and rallies. They may say, yes, we want a country, we want our own country. But of course, they said that we are peaceful. But the, what the military will respond in is they will respond with violent force. And there was a time when groups were saying, you are killing our people. Government did not make any effort to investigate them. So the soldiers were given a wild card to kill as much as they want, as long as they are members of a particular organization. Nobody questions. Our president does not even pretend to set up a committee of inquiry. The National Assembly does not set up a committee where they hear that one or two youths of this country has been murdered. You see, when you do this over a long period of time, you begin to toughen up the citizens. And what have we seen? We have seen a situation where citizens now directly confront the military. They confront a police formation, sack the police formation, kill some escapes, they raid them, they take their arms. Military checking points, they will attack soldiers, kill the ones they will kill, and take their arms. This is the situation. Mr. Justin, you are hearing it. It happened in Rivers yesterday. It happened in Rivers today. It is happening almost everywhere in Niger State, in Kebbi today, in Kebbi State. A divisional police was overrun, DPO was killed, and 8 police officers were murdered. Mm. These are things you're seeing. Because when you leave these issues that should have been deliberated on, some people locked the system and said there will be no dialogue. There will be no issue to be deliberated upon some issues. You don't listen to the voices of the majority. Let me give you an instance. We who are moderates of the Southeast, who have been preaching and giving hope that there is hope of change within the Nigerian system, we have become like, we have become blackmailed. A situation where those who had extreme views and radical views of the solution to Nigeria's problem are now seen as prophets. They are not seen as prophets. So we have been narrowed. We can't even talk to our youths anymore because the situation of the country, we are like today, somebody who is not from your place, Fulani herdsmen will kidnap someone in the bushes of Okigwe, Anambra, and Enugu State, hold them in our backyard until they collect ransom. Nobody takes those kind of things. So because of the failure of the system, you are beginning to see this kind of civil strife.
All right,
bringing up here and there. There may be criminal elements, but they have gotten a way of legitimizing their oppression by reason of the various unsolved issues, unsolved problems within our politics.
All right, thank you, Kissinger. Let's get a security analysis to all of that now. Dixon, I also want to hear from you concerning, the issue of alleged fifth columnist in all of that is happening in Imo State and, of course, in the Southeast. Plus, let me read out a comment I got on social media, on Twitter, to be precise, when I was researching on this particular topic. Someone tweeted and said they attacked the police headquarters, a military barracks, now Hope Uzodinma's house. He now went on to say, I wouldn't be shocked if they start attacking government villas and, of course, government properties. What does all of these hold in the nearest future? Plus, I also want you to respond to the issue of alleged fifth columnist.
Well, coming from the side of alleged fifth columnist, I will not take a departure from that. But first of all, let me tell you that what is playing out go line in line with the audio of IPOP leader Nnamdi Kanu, because I listened to the audio very well a few days back, and to kill soldiers and take their guns. And I just laughed, you know, because you can't be taking safety and putting the Igbo nation at risk and putting Nigerians at risk. And I want to also let you know, Justin, that if Inamdi Kanu succeed in instigating this fire violence and any civil war breaks out, from my predictive analysis, over 36 million Nigerians will die within the next 3 years if the war perhaps lasts for 3 years. And also over 20 million Igbo people will die within the next 3 years. 10 million pregnant people, a lot of issues going to happen, because from 1967, about 5 million people died during the war. We must be very careful, and our leaders, the people of the Southeast, must talk to our youth. The way Inamdi Kanu is taking this war, I don't think he will live to appreciate that. I will advise him to calm down and also have a negotiation with the government. I will also want the government not to write off Inamdi Kanu, because when you look into statistics on the causation or the result of a war that might break out from this incident, I have told you today that it's going to run into millions. So now, coming back to your fifth columnist, you know, when it comes to terrorism or state of insecurity, definitely we'll have one or two people that will want to play the role of fifth columnist, you know, in disguise. Looking at the attack on the police commission, first headquarters, I felt so painful, because I think there is an absence in target hardening, you know. Before you can be able to penetrate a police headquarters, you need to pass through what we call concentric circle or defense index. So I will advise the Nigerian police to look into defense index so that the criminal will not easily progress in their criminal activities. They must experience delay, because criminals don't like delay. That means that the Nigerian police and other government agency must tighten up their security, tighten up their perimeters, their protection in depth, so that when these criminal guys arrives, they will experience delay. And when they experience delay, I believe the responding team that will respond to these activities will curtail with them. But I will advise the Nigerian government to look inward, just like Kissinger mentioned. He made mention of a very important point, that governments sometimes don't care, you know, to address the public. The silence of our president for so long has brought us to this stage.
All right, Kissinger, Ikoko, you are from the Southeastern extraction. Let me get your candid opinion right now. Or some might say I'm trying to play a devil's advocate, but nonetheless, would you say the governors in the Southeast have been truly honest as regards the situation in their domain?
They are part of the problem. And because of the lining of the president, they also caused this problem that has come upon us. First, the entire nation, from Edo to Kogi to Anambra to Kebbi to Katsina to Zamfara, have issues of herders who have left their business, who no longer have cows, are now making brisk business from kidnapping. They overrun a community, even in Katsina, the state of the president. They take women, they take your cow, they take everything. The cattle rustling is happening in Kaduna State. It's happening almost everywhere. But we are living in denial. Everyone expects the president of the country to rise up and take a position against wild grazing of cattle. It is shaking the entire foundation of this country that somebody will have the right to be in your backyard and go to the bushes at your backyard and then can do anything and disappear into the bush. And everybody is saying, we can ranch this. We can talk about ranching. And the governors of the northern states say, no, they have the right. The president said, no, they have the right. And now look at what happened. The governors of the southwest took the bull by the horn. They are more APC than the southeast. They launched Amoteku and banned open grazing. The governors of the southeast did not take the initiative. And they forgot that is the view of the majority of their citizens. The majority of the citizens, I'm telling you, Justin, in Imo State, in Abia State, in Anambra State, in Enugu State, is that they don't want people grazing cattle wildly, because their goats and their chickens are well domesticated. But somebody else is grazing his cattle wildly in people's farms. And when you try to challenge them, they kill you and go into the bush. Nobody even know the identity of the person who is in this community or the person in the next community. They can come by night and leave by early morning. And then the Southeast governors neglected that call. Now, they just did that on Sunday. They are now banning open grazing. There is a talk in my place that if you dissected the grass cutter meat in time when it was shot, the meat wouldn't have decayed. So if they took the initiative when the Southwest governors, you know, the citizens wouldn't have lost the trust of their citizens. The Southwest governors were more APC. Governor Fayemi is the chairman of the APC Governors Forum, or whatever. But he banned open grazing and launched their Moteku. Ondo State governor is APC. He banned open grazing, took strong initiative. Governor Tom is defending the citizens against the aggression of these herdsmen. The governors of the Southeast frustrated that move, even when the citizens called for it. Okay. They called for a regional security outfit. They called for banning of open grazing. The governor said they were useless for whatever reason, because of the lining of the president.
All right.
That was what now made some other people now take the initiative of the ESF and every other thing you now had.
All right,
now,
thank you,
when they now started talking about it, the people now say, we don't believe in you anymore. You don't protect us.
All right.
You see how everything is unraveling.
All right, thank you for your thought. Let's begin to wrap up on this particular segment with Dixon Osaje. The Southeast governors, you know, they have met twice indeed, and now they came out with a regional security outfit, which they have tagged them Ebube Ago. That's and the glory of you know, the tiger. Do you think with this new development, it will actually stem the tide of insecurity in the Southeast region? As we close, please just wrap it up in time for us.
Well, thank you very much, Justin. You see, one of the mistakes of the Southeast governor was that they were so relaxed. You know, they gambled with security. You know, I've said it on many fora. Human lives are irreplaceable. That is why you need to prioritize your risk. In the past 3 years, our government, both in the Southeast and Southwest and South-South, Northeast, they have been talking about cows ranching without prioritizing human life. We took almost 3 to 4 years discussing the residence of cows, which is a big shame to this great nation. We must look into risk priority. We must look into human factors, human mechanism, because human life comes first. Well, we'll prioritize human life first, and we'll apply immediate alacrity in any mitigation factors. Well, finally, if the state governors have finally come to their senses and they're establishing the Ebube Ago, well, I congratulate them. But I think that was a very, very late approach, because a lot of complaints has been coming out from the Southeast, and they all went to bed until the Eastern Security Network are taking the bull by the horn. They now felt that they have been threatened in their security network.
All right, I know I said the last question, but I'm just tempted to just cheap one in finally. Indeed, in your opening, Salvo, you talked about how over 200 lives, you know, have been lost in just 1 week alone. Looking at the general state of insecurity in Nigeria, what do we need to do in the immediacy?
200 lives has been lost where?
Across Nigeria, you know, both in the north, both in the east, as in so far, with the killings we've had so far, and, you know, in recent times, over 200 Nigerians, you know, have lost their lives.
Oh, yes. You know, we don't have value for human lives, you know. We don't have value for human lives. If we truly have value for human life, Justin, I think the government, from the strategic center of gravity, that is from the from Abuja, would have declared a state of emergency and go after this criminal element with speed and momentum. But here we allow these criminals to relax, to build in strength and momentum, and start hitting hard on our academic system, our citizens, our brothers and sisters. I feel that the international community are just looking at us as a jokers. And that's why some few weeks ago, Twitter believed that Nigeria is not a place for their business to be certified safe.
Right.
So I think the governments must wake up, and they must understand that the threat is imminent. They must carry out a national vulnerability analysis and national risk assessment so that they'll be able to protect.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. Indeed, we have been looking at the state of insecurity in the Southeast region with a special mention of the attack on the governor of Imo State, that's Hope Uzodinma's house. And I was joined by Kisinga Ikokwa, public affairs analyst, who joined me from Imo State, and of course, Dixon Osaji, a security expert, who also joined me. Many thanks once again, gentlemen. We do appreciate it.
Thank you, Justin.
All right. We'll take a short break. When we return, we'll be speaking on the kind of leaders we need to elect in 2023. Stay with us.